Not everything metal was created equal.
What an ugly thing to say.
The Metal Sucks Podcast. Shiggity Chuck and Godless attempt to bring order to chaos or just make stupid jokes about dumb people.
Stupid. A person below normal intelligence.
This is the Metal Sucks Podcast.
Greetings and salutations, my fine metal friends. Welcome to another edition of the Metal Sucks Podcast. I am Chuck.
I am Godless.
And this is your weekly examination of all things metal, the Metal Sucks Podcast. So you can find us all over the place. If you haven't subscribed to us on iTunes, feel free to go ahead and do that. That's one way to get a hold of us. Also, you can listen to us every Monday right here at MetalSucks.net. And we got a little podcast page if you haven't noticed that. Click on the podcast page. You can listen to all the old podcasts. They're all listed right there in one foul swoop, if you will. So all the fabulous interviews we've had with so many people over the past year.
There's some great
all
ones
stacked right there. No, actually, there's
some
good
great
stuff.
Ones. But I'll tell you, if you get through this one,
this is a good
and
one.
And you want more? I'm gonna be a little surprised.
We have we've been trying to get somebody on the podcast for quite some time. His name is Nick Hipa, and he is a member, of course, formerly of Azalea Dying, and now of the band Wovenwar. And
you're playing a new song from Wovenwar to this episode, right?
Dude, totally, man. They've got a brand new song called The Mason, which we're going to play that in this episode. And we
not the carpenter.
The Mason. That's right. Exactly. I wonder if that's a, is that a, is what's the conspiracy theory? Is that, oh, damn it.
What, like Jesus' brother?
No, not Bilderberg. Son of a bitch. I'm screwed. Alex Jones is going to hate me. What the hell? I don't know my theories well enough.
Jason was a mason. Jesus was a mason and not a. Not a carpenter?
No, I'm screwed. My brain ain't functioning correctly right now. It's okay, though. But this we wanted to interview him for a while because, of course, obviously, there's been so much stuff coming out with Tim Lambesis getting sentenced and all the stuff that's happened with Azalea Dying and a lot of silence, unless they were poked and prodded into making some kind of statement on Facebook or wherever that, you never heard from the other side of the camp. You never got a word from anybody from the old Azalea Dying band other than Tim Lambesis. And finally, we got a chance to talk to Nick and really kind of lay things out, which is pretty cool.
Yeah, and I got to say, I think just about everything we wanted to know, Nick was willing to talk to us about.
Totally, man. He was definitely forthcoming about pretty much everything.
Pretty much. There's a couple things that I'm curious about just because I'm morbid.
Yeah.
But beyond that, everything, what were you saying right before we started recording? It was perfect. You were saying, like, they've been quiet all this time. You know that Nick doesn't want to necessarily talk about it.
And the thing is that nobody, after you listen to this interview, everybody else who does interviews, you don't have to ask him anything else.
Right. Listen to this one.
Because
go ahead.
It's all right there.
Go ahead. Ask Nick, what was the inspiration for the name Wovenwar? Go ahead and do that. The only thing we didn't ask was Worshipper.
Oh,
that was the only thing.
How we got skunked on Worshipper?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, I think that may be because we find out about his Christian values in this interview as well. We talk about Christianity. We talk about Wovenwar. We talk about all the stuff with Tim, including the interview that he did with Ryan Downey and a bunch of other stuff. So we're turning this episode. We're going to shut our asses up and we're basically going to turn it over to us talking to Nick because we got to talk to him for over an hour. And I think that's more interesting than anything. It's much more interesting than us talking about Slipknot and Mudvayne and Mushroomhead going on tour, which that was the other option for a topic today. So
I haven't heard that song in like 3 weeks. It doesn't matter.
It's still in your head.
It's still in my head.
All right. Well, let's get to it then. The Metal Sucks Podcast with Nick Hipa. Nick, what's going on? It's Chuck and Godless from the Metal Sucks Podcast, man. How you doing, brother?
Oh, I'm doing well. How are you, man?
Oh, doing good, man. Doing good. Great to hear from you.
Nick. Nick.
What's up?
Man, we have been talking about getting you on this show for a while now.
And we are so excited that you are willing to talk to us now.
Yeah, yes. Definitely.
We're looking forward to talking about everything with you for a little while.
Okay, sounds good. Yeah, whatever you guys want. And thanks for being really patient you know, we discussed maybe talking a little bit earlier in the year, but I think we kind of wanted to just maybe just wait a little bit, and I think now the timing is pretty good.
Was that your call or the lawyer's call?
Man, that was I think just the resounding sentiment amongst everyone. It's just like, let everything that's happening just kind of play out and just not focus on those things, because we're ultimately involved in it, but it's not part of our lives. But ultimately, when we knew we were going to come around to talking about Wovenwar, we would have to talk about it then. So we would rather have just saved it, and done it when we needed to and not any earlier.
Well, that's my first question to you is how are you doing, man? How are you? Has anybody asked Nick how Nick is doing? How are you doing? Are you okay?
Yeah, man. I'm good. Like, all things considered, even the past year, like, it was definitely a challenging year, professionally, having our careers pretty much just compromised in the way it was, and also some personal things different guys in the band had going on. But at the end of the day, I mean, there's still so much for us to be, like, I guess, just thankful for. And I think we try and be pretty positive guys, and we live in a beautiful place. I was surfing all last year because I was home a ton. I have my health. Like, I don't know, there's so many things to be happy about, and we were working on music. So even though there was a lot of things that we could chalk up into the, like, man, this is kind of a bummer category, like, I don't think we ever let it just, like, truly defeat us and, bring us down. So thank you for asking. I think myself and the rest of the guys are doing just fine.
Now, I mean, have you had that positive attitude throughout the whole thing, or has it been just like everything else, like up and down and all over the place, just sort of random as it comes at you?
Definitely. There's some times where we were all pretty down, or like personally, I just had things going on and I'm like, man, this kind of sucks. I'm not like exactly stoked, but I was always raised, like, my mom had always just told me that you can't really dwell on the things that you have no control of, and that you have to just focus on what it is that you can do within situations that get presented or built around you. So I always just tried to, I guess, lean more on that. Like, that was just the way I was raised. So, when things did start to kind of get lame, I'm just like, man, I'm gonna go surf for 2 hours and just try and think about what I should do, and then we'll come back and play music and see what comes of it from then. And I think that kind of process also really yielded some, like, music that me and the rest of the guys are proud of, because we didn't really know what to do other than, like, pick up our guitars and just riff around,
So was it, like, stressful or depressing, or was it, like, all the stages of, like, one of those relationships that go sour? You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, it was everything. We were angry, we were upset, we were disappointed, we were sad. But one of the things that's, like, I think that, like, people on the outside don't realize is that this is a very personal situation for us, because it wasn't about the band. It was about people that, a lot of people that were a huge part of our lives.
Yeah.
Tim's ex-wife was somebody that we had like lived with and toured with and, known for over a decade. This was somebody that was like family to us. And when they adopted, when she adopted those kids, we adopted them into our lives. So they were family to us, and when he had decided to leave them a year before this all went down, that created a lot of turmoil within the band. And so then it was just a very heavy and complex situation that nobody really understands. It's not just like, oh, hey, like, we're in a band and everything's fine, and all of a sudden this guy, like, makes a mistake, and then this is what happens. It was this long process that was very involved, that before, during, and afterwards, still weighs heavy on us, to a certain extent. So, I think we experienced, like, every emotion you would think.
Yeah, I mean, you talk to band members, and you guys spend day and night and on the road together, and, I mean, it's more of a family. They're brothers and all that. So, I mean, that's got to be painful to watch, especially when you have no control over that situation, that you're just kind of an observer seeing what's going on.
Yeah, for sure. It is interesting you bring that up, because or at least refer to it as being an observer, because, we definitely were flies on the wall to somebody just going down a path that was very sad to see them go down. And when you are that involved with each other, you try and you hope to reason with somebody and maybe just get them to see, like, hey, man, what are you doing? but you know, some people just can't be reached because they either they're super stubborn or that they think they know better, and it was just a very intricately complicated dynamic, and we always just try to focus on how to make things work, you know, in spite of a lot of the things that we didn't agree on, you know, towards the end of the, you know, the past few years, I guess.
I think a lot of fans, after this all went down, you know, obviously everybody was just like, what's going on? And then, hey, what's going on? You know what I mean? Like, because you guys were absolute radio silence for, man, a good part of a year, you know? So, yeah, I guess it's kind of curious. I think everybody wants to know, like, from the inside, did you see this train going off the tracks? Did this hit the station that you thought it was going to hit or something different? I mean, what were you kind of seeing happening as Tim was kind of going off the rails?
I think anybody in a band, any dude in a band who is possibly listening to this, they are very well aware of their bandmates' highs and their lows, you know, the strengths of their characters and their flaws. And you kind of just accept each other for it. I mean, even, you know, I think even to the extent that you're like, man, you know, this dude sucks, but like he's got all this other things going for him. But for us, you know, we started to just see the degradation of character to it's like, man, like there's nothing like really redeeming here. It's just like this guy is losing touch and like, what do we do? You know, like this is somebody that we're involved with on multiple levels. And so we just tried to keep things together as well as we could and not let any of those things like ruin the band and what we had built. But when this had happened, I think we were surprised. Like we weren't shocked like everyone else. This came out of the blue for everyone else. Like attempted murder is gnarly. So yeah. for us, we did not expect things to go as far as they did, but it wasn't completely like out of the question, out of character in our mind. We're just like, man, he even managed to do something like this gnarly, like that sucks. And it just, part of the reason why we chose not to say anything is because, you know, for as much as we've been around and to see, you know, so many poor decisions and just actions on his behalf, like we just never felt like it was our place to try and like speak negatively of his character, and we still have no desire to. Like the whole point with Tim now is that he just needs to figure out a lot of things, and he needed help in a big way that was beyond anything that any of us or anybody else around him, his friends or family, could figure out. So it's just still not our place to try and put him down, because he's made himself look pretty bad already, you know, and he's ruined a lot of people's lives, you know, in the process. So we just didn't really want to say anything because we didn't really have anything to say. Like everything that was coming out and everything that people were hearing were what was happening. But for us, like the only times we were drawn to like make statements were when he had taken it upon himself to do things that in our minds were just kind of, like crazy, just to make statements on behalf of us.
Well, he was drawing you guys in, like he was kind of trying, it felt like he was trying to pull you guys into it.
Yeah, and he definitely succeeded in that, but he only succeeded in that to the extent where it's like, you know, if somebody's saying something that's just not true and it negatively affects you, we had to say something, we had to respond, and it just bothers me so much that we even gave into it, you know, but it's like, you can't let this be out there. Like, I couldn't imagine us, you know, putting up another Wovenwar song or putting up another, you know, studio update, knowing that somebody challenged our character or tried to make light of a situation that they created and make themselves look like the victims and blame everyone else, when really there's truly victims in this situation that nobody knows of, and they are 100% victims by his, you know, by his activities and everything. So it was just wrong, and it sucks that we even had to say anything, because we would rather have just focused on the music and what we were doing and the future. But it was just instigated, I think, in those two instances. And now, you know, the time has come where we have to talk about Wovenwar. We have to like try and promote this record. And so, you know, these questions and things that people want to know about, you know, that's something we're going to have to address. So we're not going to just shy away from it because it's an important part of our past, and it ultimately dictated our present and you know, our future.
Well, you guys, I mean, you definitely took, I would say, no matter what, you guys took the high road in the end of all of this.
Well, you got off the road.
Yeah, well, exactly. It's like, and by not saying anything, that's taking the high road. You're not criticizing. Yeah. You're not speaking to it. So I totally get that, and I applaud you for that. But at the same time, it left a lot of people going, well, what happened to you guys? Are you guys okay? You know, like, for those people who were concerned about you, and I'm sure the people that were close to you obviously know, but as far as fans and stuff are concerned.
Yeah, you know, I mean, maybe that was like, you know, that was a really hard call for us to not, like, I guess, communicate as much as we did. Because while there is the, you know, the capacity for us to, you know, to potentially say something that gets construed as negative, there is also the, I guess, the place where we do need to just, like, let the people who love us and support us just know that we're all right. And I think we just chose silence either way because we just didn't want to run the risk of creating drama. Like, that's the last thing any of us wanted. So, you know, for anybody that was concerned and is maybe a little bit upset that we didn't say anything sooner, it wasn't out of disrespect or the fact that we weren't grateful for that support. It's just we felt like by doing so we run the risk of opening ourselves up to something that could be viewed as negative. So we just decided it wasn't worth it. Our apologies to anybody that we bummed out for not.
I think it's great that you're coming out and talking now and being open about it because, you know, Chuck and I were talking before we got on the phone. Like someday they're going to make a movie about this whole situation. And the question would be, who plays Nick Hipa, right? Is it going to be Brad Pitt or is it going to be some extra? And, you know, you're going to come out and make sure that Brad Pitt is playing Nick Hipa, right?
Well, kind of. I think I'm going to opt for Jason Momoa, the dude that plays Khal Drogo.
Nice, dude.
So that's the only thing I would add to that.
I don't know. Don't get me started on Game of Thrones, man. I don't want to go down that road.
So was As I Lay Dying? Was Tim's role in AILD like sort of at risk before this even all went down, just because of how crazy he was getting?
Oh, no, man. I mean, like, Tim started the band, you know, and he was the vocalist, and he was the guy that everyone identified with, you know. Kids, so many kids looked up to Tim, and, you know, that was never lost on us. And for us, we had never gotten to a position where, you know, over the past several years, we're like, oh, somebody needs to go, you know. It was just like, man, these are everyone's personalities, you know. Like, I have my quirks, like Phil has his quirks, everyone has their quirks, and you're just like, man, like, we're just in the most involved situation, like, involved relationship. And granted, he started to get, like, Tim started to kind of, you know, really get out there, but we always just try to be professional and make things work. And so it's like, man, I mean, if this person's going to keep on doing what they're going to be doing, like, how do you coexist with somebody and not let it destroy the you know, this thing that we built. And we always just try and find a way around circumstances that we don't understand. And for us, even though I think all of us were getting pretty unhappy towards the end there, we would never get to a position where we'd be like, oh, like, this guy needs to be replaced, because Tim, I mean, that was our singer, you know what I mean? And even when he got arrested, we never even gave two thoughts about continuing on As Lay Dying with him, you know, even though, you know, we wrote all the music and we had performed written and performed everything across the last several As Lay Dying records. It's just, it would have felt unnatural either before or after to think about not doing it with him. So, things got tough personality wise towards the end, but, you know, all of us were just trying to make it work.
Is it strange to you that he may feel completely different than that?
Different about maybe our role or his role?
About him carrying on the band without you guys?
No, that doesn't strike me as too weird, because that's kind of in line with
the narcissism that we've seen recently.
Yeah, I don't want to go so far as to just, I don't want to say that, but I mean it. If you read the interviews or, you know, some of the, even the statement that he posted on the As Lay Dying site, he definitely underplayed a lot of the contributions of everybody else in the band. You know, you know, that we built that band just as much as he did. But I mean, I think that maybe, you know, when you're in a position like him, your mind goes into a million different places and things, and it seems like he's kind of thinking along the same lines as he always has. And who knows what he's going to do? But you know, in our hearts, we couldn't and wouldn't want to do that band without him. But I definitely don't think it's reciprocated, and that's fine. You know, we're just different types of people.
Especially now, it seems like.
Yeah. You know, I think we were always a little bit different, but I think that's, again, with any band, it's a culmination of five different personalities, four or five different personalities.
Yeah.
You just figure out how to meet in the middle. But
yeah, because I think about those, I guess, you know, Randy Blythe talked about that with his problem with alcohol that he had for a while, where he was getting fights with dudes on the bus and stuff like that, and he had to change the way that he was living and how it was going, except he... You know, he didn't put on 50 pounds of muscle and get tattooed everywhere. And, you know,
he's got some tattoos,
a few, but you know what I mean? It's like it figured out what was going on and changed and made it work. Whereas I don't think Tim ever got to that point or wasn't able to get to that point. Maybe now that's what'll happen.
You know, what's so crazy about that is, or just bring up that Randy thing, is that we were on that tour. That was our first time ever being in the UK in 2004. We were with Lamb of God when Mark and Randy had gotten into that fight, and it was super gnarly. I was just like, man, these guys are like really, really, really gnarly, and just that they had strong personalities that were very different from each other, and they took it out on each other in a very severe way.
Who won the fight?
I don't remember.
Oh, come on. I think Mark won the fight because Randy was hammered.
Yeah, and plus he's real skinny and stuff.
Yeah, well, I think Randy had like a few black eyes, but I know Mark didn't play the show in Liverpool because of his shoulder or something like that. And we were just like, whoa, Willie's playing this by himself, like crazy. But the whole reason I say that is because, you know, knowing those guys or just meeting those guys as their opening band, they were super cool, and I was like, oh, all these guys are rad. And on the outside, just from meeting them the first time, I was like, man, those guys are like a band of brothers. Like, everything is tight. But then a few weeks later, we got to know them a little bit, and we hung out a little bit more, and we kind of saw that side of them, like, just being a real band and not getting along sometimes to the point where they got in a fight. And I was just like, oh, my God, like, these guys, like, really have that whole band dynamic going on. But what's cool about Lamb of God is those guys have always been the most professional... just professional guys that I could think of. They were extremely different personalities back then, and they worked it out. You know, they made that work. A lot of those guys overcame their demons, and just, I don't know, I've got nothing but respect for those guys. And it's just, I think every band has every band has that crazy relationship with, you know, with each other. And there's also some of those guys that have the capacity to do something that's pretty gnarly. You know, it happened that, like, we were that band that somebody just, I mean, we aren't the only band that had a band member do something gnarly, but, I mean, we were one of them.
But between you and me, Nick, if my skinny-ass singer beat me up in a fight, I'd be on a steroid regime, like, the next day.
Oh, man. If that's what you think is gonna get him back, but that's, I don't know, that's kind of what is... interesting about it, like if you guys are getting in a fight, then the problem is a lot deeper than that, you know.
Well, you're a surfer, dude. So do you have better abs than Tim?
Well, I guess it. Oh man, I guess it would depend on what stage of Tim we're talking about. You know, he was extremely extremely fit for a solid year or two when he was very much into his gym culture stuff. And yeah, there was no way. Like, he was like shredded, but I mean, it was unnatural, you know.
So were you like watching him like as he progressed, and then you're like, oh my god, the abs are about the same as mine now, and then like 2 weeks later they got better.
You know, I just couldn't help but notice the progress he's making. But since him and I are the guys that were into health and fitness, we would go to the gym a lot, and I would just see him just get like unbelievably gnarly out of nowhere. And I was just like, oh my god, like what's going on?
What was he benching?
I got a lot more than what I was doing. We would go to the gym, and I would do my sets, and he would throw on like plates upon plates and do his sets, and it's like, dude, how did you get so strong out of nowhere?
So which member of Wovenwar can you take?
Yeah.
Can you beat up Shane or
Yeah,
because if I were you, I would have chosen Shane half the voice and half because I could kick his ass if he doesn't fall in line.
Dude, well, Shane is a pretty massive guy. Like he's 6'4" and he's he's a pretty
really
like yeah he's 6'4" and he's I don't know how heavy he is, but he's really strong. Like
wow,
I don't know.
Maybe that's a mistake.
Yeah,
no, I never realized he was that tall. I was like, damn.
Yeah, no, Shane's a pretty massive guy, but luckily I do not foresee any of us getting to a point where we would even want to fight each other. And
oh, wait a minute, now this makes sense. When Tim gets out, they got Shane to protect themselves from.
Ah.
No, it's not. Yeah. God, I don't even know how to respond to that.
Dude, it's like the old circus magazines. You remember those? Like, they used to be like Motley Crue versus Van Halen, you know? Like, someday that's going to be like the big headline.
Dude, I think we've been on tour with bands sometimes where we had just, like, talked about, you know, which band would win in an overall band-on-band fight. But I can't think of a good response to a member-on-member fight. At least for our band. Everyone's got their own little tricks up their sleeves.
Right? It would be so much like that Anchorman scene, you know, but better.
No, see, Phil's a big guy, but he hits everybody in the balls. It's just, boom, that's his move. It's what he does every time. Yeah. Crazy.
Yeah, somebody's going to bust out their trident, and it's going to get way too gnarly.
Exactly. So was there, at any point, was there a thing, especially once, I imagine early on, you're like my buddy Shane, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so was there like, any consideration to kind of go, hey, I wonder if Tim will let us take the name, or did you know from the get-go this had to be something different?
From the get-go, we felt it had to be something different because we didn't want to continue on the band's name. Like, in spite of everything that Tim got in trouble for, like, Tim, you know, the attempted murder and everything, like, and the stuff that he needed to work on, it's just like, man, this guy was the singer of the band, and he wrote all the lyrics, and he just is a part of it, and I don't think myself nor the rest of the guys would have felt comfortable continuing to play those songs live, continuing to use the name when it's just not what it was. And we would rather just do something entirely new that feels right and that our hearts are in, instead of trying to salvage whatever we could from the past.
Now, Wovenwar is a very different thing musically as well. Is it a case of we want to do something different and then the music followed, or was it we're making some different music, it makes sense that we call it something different?
Well, I think for us, knowing that we were starting a different band, we pretty much just removed all of the limits we would have placed on ourselves in As Lay Dying, because in As Lay Dying we were very mindful of what the sound of the band was. We knew what people liked of us and what they expected of us. So when we wrote an album, we always tried to honor that, you know, but still as musicians trying to just expand and grow the sound and keep things creative and interesting for us. But in like adhering to that specific sound, and also with the limited abilities that we that everyone had, like we were always going to sound like that band. With Wovenwar, you know, bringing Shane in, Shane is a very talented guy. You know, he's a great guitar player and amazing songwriter, and he's got this cool voice. And somebody who's that multifaceted, I think that, you know, there's a lot more room to experiment with things. And for us, you know, we jumped at the opportunity to just expand completely and just make music that really didn't have any limits, because there was a new name, you know, so we dictated what the band would sound like. And that was what was so exciting to us, was just making music, because it was whatever, like all the elements of what makes the band is what everyone does really well.
Going into it, did it worry you to have to start basically from scratch again? I mean, after you had built such a big, well, brand in As I Lay Dying, yeah. Was it worrisome to have to basically start from the beginning again with a new band?
Yeah, well, you know, it was definitely, we're definitely a little, not, I don't know what the way to put it is, but we are very aware of how long we have to go and how much we have, and how hard we have to work, because, you know, we put in 10 years to get As Lay Dying to the level that it was at. You know, the band has been around for maybe 11 or 12, and it took forever. And those were like our good years, you know, when we were in our young 20s, or, you know, some of us when our teens fell. And we were totally stoked to just endure whatever miserable condition was thrown our way. It's like, yeah, we're doing it. You know, who cares? But now we're straight up like, you know, in our 30s. Like, I'm 31 now. Jordan's 31. The rest of the guys are still in their 20s, but we're not exactly like young by any means. So the idea of having to start from the beginning and relive some of those experiences, it's a little disheartening. So you're just like, man, like, even after all that work, we still have to start here. But it's what I love. It's what all of us love, you know. And it's, I would rather spend the next 10 years of my life just, you know, slaving over trying to make the band work, you know, if we can, because it's just what my heart is into. And I know that my quality of life would be way better if I was writing music and playing music that I cared about with people that I love, you know, than just not doing that. So it is a little bit daunting to think about how much work we have in front of us. We're like completely ready and I think mentally prepared for it all.
I mean, you do have a leg up on a lot of bands starting out.
Oh,
I mean,
absolutely.
But at the same time, that
got hooks.
Well, that too. But the you got a little bit of a leg up, but also you've got a lot of history too, obviously. So you're going to want to be talking about a lot of the past as well. But do you think it's going to be beneficial, or do you think it's going to be something that's going to hold you guys back?
I don't think it will hold us back because we're a brand new band, you know. So where we lose what we had will also not keep us back. Hmm. If that makes sense.
Yeah.
This is a new thing, so hopefully people will be able to listen to it. And because it sounds so different, you know, hopefully it'll you know, get legs of its own. That's really all we can you know, say, because it's so uneasy to just think about how much luck is involved with music. Because I know so many bands that are just insane, and so many musicians that I think are incredible. I'm like, why isn't that band bigger? You know, I feel like this should be the biggest band in the world, because everyone is like the sickest musician I've ever heard, and they got great songs, you know, and everything works. And so there's just no way to dictate what the masses will say, or, you know, even like the niche audience that we had in the first place. So I guess we're just not worrying about it. We're just trying to do what we know we can do and hopefully do it well, and hope that kind of hard work, you know, does yield some sort of support. You know, I think we'd like to believe that there's just like a place in this world for just like, you know, honest music and just riffs.
You mentioned earlier that everybody or just about everybody in the band was going through their own sort of personal turmoil for the past year, related or unrelated to what was going on with Tim. Has most of that sort of resolved itself at this point? Do you guys feel like personally you're in a good spot?
Yeah, you know, like, the personal things that we have going on are there. I would say no, but, you know, I think we're handling them better. And those are like things that, you know, I don't, out of respect to the other guys, I don't know if I can bring up, but, you know, when people close to you get very, like, terminally ill or things like that, that's a different, like, sort of challenge that puts everything else into perspective. You know, it's like, oh, okay, like, the band fell apart, and it's just like, you know, it's this big thing that I don't know what I'm going to do with my future, but this person that I loved one, or this loved one and this person that I really care about, they're fighting for their lives. You know, that kind of stuff makes everything else seem quite arbitrary. And, you know, whether, like, it was relationships falling apart or people just, I don't know, people just dealing with their own issues, like, amongst the rest of us, it was a tough year. But I think because we went through all of that together, at this point in time, I feel like we, and it sounds like the ultimate cliche, but I feel like we're all, like, stronger and more mature individuals that have a better understanding of just how to handle those types of situations.
You do realize that another member of As I Lay Dying cannot go to jail, because, I mean, it just can't happen.
If so, for money laundering or something like that.
You know? Even then.
No.
No.
Yeah, I guess we did get the whole, like, the whole novelty of just going to prison kind of taken away from us because, yeah, you're right. That can't happen to anybody.
Yeah. But you know what? If you all get sent to jail and you get sent to the same jail with Tim... that's not so bad.
Then it's a story.
Yeah, Johnny Cash's Folsom Prison ain't got nothing on that story. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I mean, that's probably a pretty hypothetical future, but I commend you for being that creative with it.
You know, there's a bunch of old fans that have just been having that fantasy for the last, 2 months, you know?
See, I see a video in their future about. See, that's an idea for a video, is
right.
What it
so
is.
So, is All Rise a recommend? You know, the title, because you guys had spent so much time in court.
You know, I think the name was actually it wasn't intended to be any sort of slight or court reference. I don't know where. I think it was I think it was a church service or something for. Or maybe a holiday service that one of us was at where, they say all rise and you just stand in reverence and all that. And I think that phrase just stuck out. Oh, all rise, that's pretty cool. And we even, for a brief moment, some of us were trying to name the band that. Hey, what if it was just all rise? But, you know, that ended up not panning out and, we abandoned that pretty quick. But we just gave that song that name because that song deals with a lot of, lyrically, I think it deals with just perseverance and just trying to navigate through a situation where somebody or an institution or I guess more specifically a corporate entity a record label would maybe just kind of exploit you. And I think that was the root of the lyrics, but ultimately it moved on a little bit more towards just anything that gets you down.
So is it got Christian sort of connotations as well?
No.
So is that now in the past, or is that going to be a part of Wovenwar?
You know, what's interesting is that was always something that was Tim's agenda. You know, Tim was very adamant about hey, this is the type of band we are, and this is what I believe, and this is what I write the lyrics about. And you know, if you trace the history of Fast Lay Dying back and you read every interview we did, Tim did the majority of the press. So I mean, you know, as the front man and the person that anyone identified with, the flag that he was flying kind of got put on us all. And I think our motives for playing music are the same as anyone else's. We love music and we love the art form and the expression, and we have no sort of religious agenda whatsoever in any of this music. I mean, I think by nature, all of us are pretty, pretty positive people, so there's a lot of optimism in lyrics, but there's nothing, I don't think there's nothing that anyone could point to as being just an evangelical or intentfully we're just not trying to share anything other than our music, I guess.
Yeah, so you wouldn't say that you would label yourself a Christian metal band like some people do?
No, I mean, I wouldn't have labeled As Lay Dying that, but mm-hmm. that got put on us all the time, and then Wovenwar is definitely not.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, some of our lyrics even wrestle with that kind of, with the sentiment of people placing expectations on us based on who they thought we were and then criticizing us when they found out otherwise. You know, and it's just unfair because, you know, people don't know you, but they think they do. And then the person that they think they know when you don't turn out to be, you know, as such, then they're just you know, they get on you and they judge you and they're harsh to you. And you're just dude, you didn't know me to begin with. So take it easy.
So when you guys were playing, you know, the festivals with other bands that were also,
that were flying that flag, that were under that moniker. Yeah.
Did the rest of you guys feel a part of that, or did you feel not a part of it?
You know, that's actually, that's a good question because some of us were extremely conflicted because all of us, everybody in the band had grown up or at least, you know, had a fair amount of their lives spent in just a Christian church and a Christian home. And it's a part of who we are. But, you know, you grow up and you grow a little bit older. And sometimes, you know, while a lot of those values remain, I think you just naturally question everything that you're taught. And you challenge the very notion of the faith that you were taught to believe. And so for us, we were fine being in those settings because it was like, this isn't weird to me. Like, I understand what these people are about, and I understand, you know, what they're saying, but I just don't know if we all 100% are in line with every single, you know, thing that they're talking about. But we're here, and I'm a guitar player. I'm here to play a show, and it's just, I feel a little uncomfortable because I feel like I'm not the type of person that they want me to be, but I just don't know what to do. It's like, am I going to be, you know, are we going to sit out? Are we just going to sit this out and let the guys who do feel comfortable play the show? You know, it was a slippery slope. And I think for some of us, we just felt like it was dishonest, but we played those shows again because that was a stigma that was put on us by the person that, for all practical purposes, was the visual leader of the band, you know, our figurehead.
So did he follow you guys as he sort of began to have these more, more publicly, obviously, doubts about his Christianity? Was he following you guys? Were you guys having those philosophical discussions in the bus?
Well, you know, what's crazy is it's like, we never, and Tim took it upon himself to make this claim by saying like, oh yeah, none of those guys are Christians. But it was just like, man, you know what? Like, I think, I believe this, you know, and I believe this and this. Like, I absolutely think that we should all treat each other, you know, treat our neighbors as we would love to, or love our neighbors like, you know, we would love to be loved back, in a very, like, layman's, like, term of putting it. Like, there's a lot of things within Christianity that we back, but then there were some things like, I just don't know, like, that just doesn't resound with me. Like, I don't know if that's necessarily something that I agree in, but never did that come out of our mouth in the form of, nah, Christianity is not for us. And it was just crazy because there was no answer. It was just a lot of discussions and back and forth amongst ourselves and like things that we personally were thinking of. But Tim is such a black and white person that for him, he was all about it. And then all of a sudden he's like, you know what, this isn't for me anymore. And I'm going to sing about it and talk about it. And since this isn't for me, like, my moral compass is gone. So I'm going to do all this stuff. And it just blew my mind because I'm like, the world is not as black and white as that. You know what I mean? Like, you can have questions of your faith, and it doesn't mean that you have to completely abandon everything and, you know, all of a sudden do whatever it is that you think you can do because you don't have to answer to anybody. It was something that he made more of a deal than us. And I just think that what we're dealing with is natural. Like, everyone, as you get older, you just question life. You question what you know, and you question what you were taught to believe. And I don't think there's anything wrong with doing that. But in doing that, I didn't feel, none of us really felt right to be, you know, for him to be outspoken about us being unanimously a Christian band. So it's just super involved, man. Like, I don't know how to express the entirety of that sort, that part of our band, but hopefully some of that makes sense.
No, it definitely makes sense. But it sounds like you guys had a much more mature way of kind of seeing the world in general, you know, versus the, because black and white to me seems like a 10-year-old.
I like black and white.
Well, but I mean, nothing, there's, I mean, the world is gray, man. There's no, the world is gray, it's brown, it's not, it's nothing has ever been black and white. But you don't realize that until you start to get a little more mature and age a little bit. So that seems like a very mature way to see things versus,
but black and white's so much easier.
Oh, it's a lot easier, and you know, lands you in jail too.
Well, yeah, well, you know, it's just, but like that, I think that it's funny because that is kind of like, you know, that does reference like even like a tenet of just like Christianity, you know, the whole idea of like, you can't be lukewarm, you have to be either hot or cold.
Yeah,
you know, that's black and white, and that was one of those things that I'm like, That doesn't seem fair to me, you know? Like, so you have to be 100% like into it or not? Like, you can't just wonder if like this makes any sense or not. And that was one of those things that, you know, that we would talk about and would come up in this, you know, in discussion. And I'm not trying to get like, you know, like a religious talk or anything like by any means.
Oh, come on, Nick.
Might as well.
No,
let's do it. If you don't believe it all 100%, then you don't believe.
Where do you stand? I mean, are you going to church on Sunday, or have you sort of gone, yeah, I don't know, so I'm not going to bother?
Yeah, well, I haven't gone to church in years, man.
But okay.
Like, yeah.
What's crazy is that it is such a black and white mentality, Christianity is. I mean, even based on that. And it's just like, if you even are that person where you're like, oh, you know, what about like this? Like, this just doesn't seem to be fair to me. I don't know. in that mentality, you know, like, because I did have that black and white mentality for a long time when I was a kid, and you automatically assume that that person is not, they're not like you, and they don't have the same values and morals and all of these things, and it's just all, they're living a lifestyle that is, you know, in complete opposition of yours because they're not 100% in support of it.
It's funny you said that, Nick, because it's funny because, like, you know, here in Texas, right, I have somebody over for dinner. I can't tell you the number of times somebody would say, oh, he's a really good dude. He comes to my church every Sunday, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, it's said as if that is required to be a good person. You know what I mean? And then meanwhile, when I'm talking to people about, hey, who is Nick Hipa? What sort of things should I ask Nick Hipa? Everybody says, Nick Hipa, nicest guy ever in the history of mankind. And so, and here I'm finding out that you managed to do it without going to church every Sunday.
Oh, well, thanks for saying that. You know, the thing is that just what's hard is that the name or the title, like, it does, like you were saying, it goes such a long way in people's minds. And it blows me away because, you know, like someone would say, like, oh, he's such a good dude. I see him at my church every Sunday. Like, that should mean nothing. You know, that doesn't mean that he's all of these things and not any of these things. It just means he goes to church on Sunday. And what's crazy is that, you know, when Tim took it upon himself to tell everyone that, like, you know, that oh yeah, none of those guys are Christians, and, you know, I wasn't a Christian, and I was doing all this stuff because I just didn't have any sort of, like, you know, spiritual foundation or anything. You know, kids read that, like, young kids who just don't know any better and are like, oh, so these guys don't believe any of those things, so they're all of these other things, you know? And the reality is, I'm the same person that I am now, and I'm the same person that, you know, or the same person that they probably met 3 or 4 years ago. The only thing that changed is what somebody, you know, the label somebody put on me. And because of that, like, kids will either choose not to support our band or not even listen to it because they straight up think that we have changed as human beings because of that one thing. And that just, it's just sad to me because it just, so much of it is unnecessary.
Well, I can tell you now that All Rise is absolutely one of the, I mean, best songs of the year, maybe more than a year. What are we talking, like, decade or something?
I put them on my best of the list so far.
I had to hold off because, you know, about, what, 25, 30 years ago, Striper put out Always There For You. I thought it was a song about a girl, and I was way into it, and then I found out it wasn't. And I refused to get burned again, so I needed to find out if All Rise.
Oh, man, that is, oh God, that is hilarious. Well, first of all, that's so cool that you like the song. Like, really, really appreciate it. And that is a very funny, but dude, you're not getting burnt at all. And if you want to ask me what any of the other songs are about, you know, just for your own peace of mind, like, I'd be happy to tell you.
When I get burned, I'll burn in hell. But other than that.
That's funny. No, I seriously, he was like worried. I played the song for him and he's like, this is really good. It's not, is it? I'm like, I don't know, man.
We're going through the lyrics with a fine tooth comb. I can't tell you how many times we had to listen to that. YouTube, one, play that line again.
Well, yeah, just to put your worries to ease. The song is about the music industry and the trials that Shane faced within it, and so it has nothing to do with anything beyond that.
Hey man, but you know, if you read something else into it, if you see something else there, it's your interpretation. Man, yeah,
shut up,
you
know? Okay. So Nick, we talked to Ryan Downey right after the Alt Press article came out, and one of the things that he was saying was that there was a lot of stuff that Tim said about Metal Blade that he didn't include in the article. What has your relationship been with the label, and what has it been with Wovenwar?
The relationship with Metal Blade has always been great, man. Like, Segel, Faley, like, all everyone at Metal Blade has been a part of our extended family for a really long time, and they're also just on a professional level invested in our careers. You know, they put a lot into As Lay Dying, you know, to help build As Lay Dying to what it became. So they were always there to just lend us support the whole time. And I know I had spoken with Ryan Downey, and he, you know, he had said that, you know, like, oh, I didn't even include all the stuff that I could have, you know, that Tim said. And that's, you know, that's fair, and I'm glad that he didn't, because I know that in reading the interview, everything else that he chose to just bring up or say about everyone else was pretty far-fetched. And especially as I know our situation and our dynamic and what he chose to say about us and how unreasonable and untrue it was, I would take anything that was in that interview as a response to a question, I would take it with an extreme grain of salt, because it's not too far-fetched to think that somebody who is willing to calculate, like, murder, you know, that person is always also mindful of misusing and abusing a public platform to speak. You just have to be aware of somebody like that. And I just think that it's something that should be approached with trepidation, right?
Did you just throw your hands up and go, God, not again, when you read that?
Yeah, I was very, I think we were all very just, we were just out of it at that point. Like, dude, are you serious? This is coming out now after the heavy day we had in the courtroom? Like, the sentencing was brutal, man. It was very emotionally draining, and we had just gotten out of that, and that thing had gotten released, and it was his attempt to just point a finger at everyone else, you know, to blame Megan for not handling, you know, their divorce that he instigated very well, to blame, you know, his drug dealer, to blame us, you know, and saying things like, if we would have pulled him aside, maybe he wouldn't have gotten, you know, maybe he wouldn't have gotten that far, when, you know, we know that we had tried to help him many times. But even in the face of that, it's not right to just say all these people are responsible for this poor decision that I made. And that's what was hard. It was like, dude, after all this time, you still can't be accountable for your behavior. It's just to me, it was disappointing, because it just showed no sign of change. And I was really, really bummed out about it. And I was super bummed that we even had to say something, you know?
Yeah. I got to say, your post on Facebook was brilliant right after that article came out. If for no other reason than you were able to slide the word woven into the first paragraph. So there's... Kudos. There's some SEO right there, man. Nice job.
Oh, man. Thanks, dude. And, you know, I think it's still just such an emotional thing to all of us. And it's a personal situation. And because it's so personal, we would rather just not talk about it, you know. But now, anytime, like one of us does an interview, you know, the two questions where we respond about Tim get taken into, those get put to a headline on some, in a post somewhere, you know, like,
yeah, we'll take care of that. No problem.
Yeah. Don't worry. We'll do that. We'll get that one for you too.
Yeah. Like, oh, this is like, you know, this person's statement, like, even though we're talking about all sorts of things, like, somebody could be like, oh, like, so-and-so says this, you know, about Tim again. And it just sucks. Cause like, dude, I'm not going to lie. I read comments all the time. Dude, I'm a metal suck every day. It's like, oh, what's going on?
Oh, you got to listen to the podcast now.
Oh, dude, yeah, I think it's a great site, and I always enjoy just the content, because it's informative, but it's always funny, and it's just one of my favorite sites. But, you know, I'll read comments about us, and, you know, for someone to just be like, oh, yeah, I hate that one guitar player that just goes out of his way to always talk negatively about Tim, I'm just, you know, there's nothing I can do, because I almost want to say, like, hey, man, I'm just trying to talk about our new band.
Right.
We're talking about our new band. People want to touch on this subject. And of course, I'll ask anything that anybody, or I'll answer anything that anyone asks of me, but it's not my agenda to speak of him, you know, and I still have no desire to try and make him look like a bad guy. Like, he's done all that for himself. It's just part of the necessary step of, I guess, just
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, and Chuck and I have talked about this before, where, like, you have to address it, because if you don't, then everybody else will take the story and do it. It's going to get talked about.
Yeah.
Let's have it happen on your terms. The only mistake you made is that you should have been here on our podcast like nine months ago. But hey, bygones be bygones. All I got to say, if Shane does anything stupid,
call us up. You got our number.
Dude, please. Can I get a promise on that?
Of course. You guys have my number now. You guys have my contact info.
Awesome. Let's do it. All
right. So how is Megan doing?
You know, Megan and the kids are they're honestly just learning how to live. That's all I can really say about it. Their lives were ruined. And it's like truly tragic to see kids who, you know, already made it through, you know, through Ethiopia, you know, as orphans, and to see, just to see them live in fear and, I don't know, just have to suffer again, like, that's just really tough, man. So, you know, we still love and support all of them, and we have their best interests in mind at all times, and if they ever need any of that, you know, this, they know that we're there for them.
Good. That's awesome.
Yeah. So I'm sorry, go recap, and you were saying you were trying to, see, this is the thing, when you say, hey, we tried to help Tim a bunch of times, he doesn't even seem to have noticed, people are going to go like, yeah, what was it? And the truth of the matter is that it really, all it could have been is you guys going up and saying, dude, come on, dude. And that should be sufficient. What was it that you guys had done?
Exactly that. It just, every time it's like, dude, what are you doing? Like, this isn't right. You know, like, think about your family. Think about the people that you were affecting by doing this. And, you know, this is, I'm definitely walking the line of disclosing more than I feel comfortable with, but we had always had very strong sentiments that we shared with him whenever he would do things that we thought sucked. And even, like, when he decided to just straight up leave his family for another person, it was something that we sat in the bus with him and were just like, dude, can't you just not do that, please? Or can you go to counseling, work out whatever your problems are? Like, just, can you try all of these things? And nobody understands this, you know, this person that they have seen on the outside for so long, but he was very logically driven, just relentless person when it came to fighting for things that he thought should be. And you it's, I don't know how you would ever get through to somebody like that. And we tried for years.
And Tim had said that, like, you guys didn't reach out to him and talk to him once he got arrested. My opinion is that you calling in the middle of the night, waiting till somebody picks up and then hanging up should count. So did you not, were you advised not to?
I think he was already said that a lot of that is bullshit.
Well, I'm asking him to go on the record.
Yeah, on the record. I talked to Tim for like a couple hours after he got out of prison. He and I were on the phone for a very long time. Josh talked to him like four or five times. Josh went to his house multiple times. Like, you know, Jordan went to his house a couple times. And that is just one of those things where it's, wow, like, when I released that post that I had, you know, just pretty much kind of said, like, hey, like, don't read into what he said, you know, 100%, because there's a lot of untruth there. We didn't want to get too into all the specifics, like, no, he was lying about this, he was lying about this, you know, right, because that just, it just becomes really petty and overly dramatic. But those were 100% lies, you know. You can talk to Josh, you can talk to any of those guys.
Oh, we want to.
Yeah, like, Josh sat with him, you know, at his parents' place where he was in house arrest and talked to him for a while. Like, it's just, it was an attempt to just paint us in a light that would, you know, he knew that kids who loved the band and who loved him would read that and immediately resent us.
Yeah.
And he knew what he was doing, and that's why I just thought it was so unfair, because I had told him when I spoke to him, I let him know, I'm like, hey man, you were impossible to get through for so long, and your decisions hurt a lot of people, but now they straight up ruined a family. And that's a family that we love, and we're going to support them. And, you know, while you figure out what it is you need to figure out, and while you rehabilitate yourself, like, these are the people that we are going to stand behind. That's what I had told him. And he chose not to, you know, not to share the truth in order to, I guess, compromise, like, what we are doing and trying to move forward in our lives. All we have been trying to do this entire time is just live our lives and do what it is that we want to do. And just not say anything of him or the situation, but he just, I don't know, he just thought that he needed to do that to us, maybe because he resents us in some degree, but I just think that that's unwarranted and unfair.
Can I ask you one last, as I lay dying question, one transition question, then one Wovenwar question?
Yeah, well, I mean, honestly, I would have liked to talk way more about
All right, these are real quick ones.
I know.
Quick ones. All right, so the first one is the Happy Father's Day tweet. Was that from Tim? Or was that from somebody else?
Yeah, well, I don't know if you guys, did you see the post he made on the As Lay Dying site a while back? I guess you guys did. Because
yeah,
guys
yeah, yeah. Because it blew your big, it blew you guys, your really big rollout. That was like kick-ass happening, and then he went and kind of pooped on it.
Yeah, well, you know, and I thought what MetalSucks did with that was so funny, and I think you dudes really managed to kind of get to the heart of what was going on there while making it like an amusing thing, and that's one of the things I always thought was great about the site.
Cool.
But in our response to that, we kind of just let everyone know, like, hey, we don't have access to any of the social accounts. Like, no, like, we couldn't go onto the As Lay Dying Facebook. We can't go onto the As Lay Dying site or the Twitter or anything, like, if we wanted to. Like, those things are just frozen. And Tim seems to be the only one who has access to it. So when that came out, that was another, like, throw our hands up in the air. Like, this is kind of funny because you've got to be kidding me. This is, God. Like, you did this. You know, Josh had sent us all a screenshot. Be like, what is this? And I was like, oh my God, like, are you serious? You know, but
facepalm. Yeah,
total facepalm, because it was just like, oh my God, like, why is this still happening? You know, like, stop making a joke out of yourself and out of our band and just leave it be, please. Don't say anything. Just leave everything. We want to leave everything be, please.
Yeah.
Everyone else, like, leave it be.
In the short or in the long term, will Wovenwar be performing any songs from the As I Lay Dying catalog for those fans?
I'm sorry to say that we probably will not. But that is out of respect to this person who's, you know, we created music with for all those years. Like, those were his songs that you know, that he wrote. Those were songs that he wrote lyrics for, and it would just feel weird for us to have somebody else singing them, you know? So I don't know. Just, we have no desire to, but it also, you know, stems from us just trying to move forward and not keeping ourselves in the past in any form.
And last question, Shane has an O Sleeper tattoo huge across his chest. Have you told him that he either must wear a shirt at all times while performing with Wovenwar, or he has to get an even bigger Wovenwar tattoo over the O Sleeper tattoo?
Wait, Shane has an O Sleeper tattoo on his chest?
Doesn't he?
Isn't it?
I'm pretty sure he does. I've seen some pics.
Yeah, he's got an O Sleeper tattoo somewhere. I think it's, like, over his heart, maybe. It's not a chest piece, but, nah, man, Shane can do whatever he wants. You know, it's just,
Will you get bummed out if he doesn't get a Wovenwar tattoo that's bigger than the O Sleeper tattoo?
I think he needs to do it like Scrabble with the O. He puts the W-O. Like,
even
the,
if he doesn't, even if he just has it above, I guess, you know, I might take it personally if he didn't.
You know what? This was something I never even thought about, but now you guys are firing me up.
Nice.
I'm gonna bring this up right now. I'm
gonna
be like, yo, dude, what's up?
Hey, what's up, man? Come on.
Meet you at the tattoo parlor. No questions.
Well, dude, I gotta hand it to you, man. You guys have definitely taken the high road in all of this situation, and in the end, it's all about living well, right? That's the best FU that you can give to anybody is living well. And you guys have done a great job with the new Wovenwar record.
We're living muscular.
And it's going to be nothing but good for you guys, man. I really think so.
This song is awesome. I can't wait to hear the rest of the album.
And the new one, Mason, is great.
Now assured that the album is Jesus free, I am way into listening to this record.
Well, you know, cool. Thank you guys so much, and thanks for even, you know, just letting me be on the podcast. It's cool to be able to talk, you know, about some of this, and, you know, I definitely recognize that the fact that, you know, it's going to come out, it's going to be like, oh, like, Hick said this about Tim, you know, it's going to be filed in, under the drama category, but hopefully people will listen to it and understand that the intention behind everything was never to be a part of such a dramatic, you know, thing. We just kind of got pulled into it.
I think that's evident from your posts and everything else, man. I don't think you can say it all you want, but I mean, honestly, I think with the way that you've kind of presented yourself and the rest of the band, has been the just you've already done that for a lot of ways. You know, people want the explanation, and I'm thank you very much for coming on the show.
Thank
for
you.
That.
Yeah,
but I think you've handled that hands down already.
I think Chuck would agree with me that we got to have an open door policy for you. Anytime anybody in your band fucks up, you're more than welcome to come on here and talk about it.
Okay, well, we should also establish a contingency in case I'm the one that ends up, like, doing something, you know, gnarly. So, it's, in that case, you should speak to, like, Josh or something.
Yeah, we're going to have to get his number before you go.
Yeah.
Awesome, man. Well, thank you, dude. The new album, when does it actually come out? What's the drop date for it?
August 5th. I believe.
Okay, so August 5th, you guys are going to be on tour with Black Label Society starting in July, which is awesome. And a lot of good things coming up for you guys.
Yeah, coming to Austin, right?
Yeah, they're coming to Austin.
Can we say hi?
Of course. Let's go hang out. Let's go do something cool.
Awesome.
All right, cool. We're incredibly dweeby in person, but
yeah.
You know, we'll bring you tacos or something.
Oh, man. I don't know. I'm a pretty... Shane and I are probably like the nerdiest dudes you'll ever meet, so... We'll get along fabulously.
Maybe we can sit down and have that Game of Thrones discussion after all. All right.
I got to catch up.
Awesome.
Well, on that topic, I mean, Shane has read all of the books at least 3 or 4 times. I've read all the books. Like, dude, we're super into it. So, yeah, I am 100% into that idea.
I read the books, but I hear they're full of spoilers.
Yeah, don't let the books ruin the show for you.
Yeah, right? No doubt. All right, Nick, dude, thank you so much, man. We definitely appreciate it, man. We'll talk to you soon.
Cool. Thanks a lot, guys.
That's the latest from Wovenwar. It's called The Mason on the Metal Sucks podcast, man. Dude.
Everything we wanted to know.
Freemasons. That's what it was. It was Freemasons. I had to look it up. Gotcha. It was a Freemason. Okay, never mind. It doesn't matter. That's my personal. I had to. Uh-huh. I know what I'm talking about. No, I actually don't.
It would be interesting if, like, the Wovenwar album, like, every song is just sort of tangentially related, you know, because if he's going to do the secular thing, it'd be kind of cool if they're doing the secular thing, but they're hinting at stuff for the Jesus lovers.
Well, if you listen to All Rise, listen to secular. Yeah, I mean, if you listen to all the lyrics in All Rise, you could interpret that. That's why it was so close for you, was because you could go, rise again, you know, I mean,
I wasn't going to get burned again.
Yeah, I mean, you could totally see where that could be interpreted as a Christian-sounding song and themes in there, but... We have been denied.
Yes.
Sorry, guys. We apologize to burst your bubble in the interview, man.
Well, I think that those folks who are like the Jesus lovers, I think that Nick is said it just right. You know, yes, it had a time and a place, but we've grown up now.
Yeah, they don't hate you.
No.
And they're not trying to push you away or anything like that. But at the same time, you know, Christians have a problem in a lot of respects being Christian and not judging other people.
And growing up.
And
they have a trouble doing that.
Putting away childish things. Yes. Godless, we appreciate it as always. Well, we thank you very much for checking out this episode with Nick. It's just basically, that's all we got time for.
Yeah.
Otherwise, we blow this thing into 2 hours worth, man. But yeah.
Thank goodness.
I'm very glad we got the chance to talk to Nick. And
any idea what we're doing next week?
I have no idea now.
Okay.
It kind of blew our schedule.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I don't know. I think next week... I don't know.
Okay. It's all good.
I don't know.
I didn't mean to throw you a curveball.
You totally threw me a curveball. I don't know what we're doing. Well, what are you talking about?
If they follow you at Bearded Ape.
That's true.
Or me at Godless Speaks.
We'll
or on Spotify, we'll tell everybody. Yeah.
Yeah. Because, I mean, we've got interviews in the bag with Between the Baron and Me. And also, we're going to talk to Josh from 68. We're going to talk to Deaf Heaven coming up. We're going to talk to a bunch of different bands. So make sure you subscribe on iTunes because you can get all this stuff come right to your device, whether it's an iPad or iPhone or whatever. Yeah, I think we're on Stitcher. We're on a bunch of different ones of those. So if you're looking for an RSS feed, go to metalsucks.net and you can get them all right there on the podcast page at Metal Sucks.
Spread the word for us. Spread the word.
Pass it on. If you think this was a halfway decent episode, you know, send it to other people. Pass it on. We would definitely appreciate it. I am Chuck.
I'm Godless.
And this has been the Metal Sucks podcast.